So here we have what I think is going to be an XL Nebula class. That's what the website calls it, but the magazine I think may call it a special issue, but we'll see shortly. And this is the USS Bonchune, NCC-70915, and it is a Nebula class. Now, if you're unfamiliar, the Nebula classes or class of ship was brought in the Next Generation era. And as you can see, it utilizes the primary hull and indeed a part of the secondary hull of a galaxy class. But its overall configuration is actually much closer to the good old Miranda class. So this is very much the next generation of Miranda, basically. So if you're familiar with Star Trek II: The Wrath of Khan, for example, the Reliant in that film was a Miranda class. This is the grown-up next generation version of it. Similar warp nacelles, everything else to the Enterprise D, because they do share the same design heritage, and it makes perfect sense for Starfleet to reuse these common components. But overall, this is a smaller ship. Yeah, so as I was expecting, you'll see there that the actual magazine defines this as a special issue, which generally speaking aren't quite as big as the XLs, but the website defines it as an XL. So I'm not really sure what to make of that, conceptually speaking. But we see one of these in the wounded. I think it is this. I think it's not this one, but it's this class, and the pod on the top of it is exchangeable. So sometimes you see them with there's an example actually. So sometimes you get these sort of AWACS style pods on the top of them, and other times you see them with these slightly more aggressive looking torpedo launcher style pods on top. So like the Reliant, they have these sort of mission specific bolt-ons that they can take. So I'm going to open this one up now. Some really nice images in this one. They've obviously really sort of concentrated on the artwork for this one, because it is quite a significant ship. I think it is probably a quite a favourite of people, because it's one of those few really genuinely new ships that we saw in the course of the Next Generation era, rather than just being a reuse of an existing ship design that we'd seen before, of course. But I think it's fair to say that that Starfleet does tend to recycle its ships pretty heavily. If they can still fly them, then they will still fly them, basically. So here she is. Let's pop her out. Whoa, she's heavy. Good lord. So that's one of these nice ones where as soon as you pick it up, that's really, really nice and heavy and solid feeling. Plastic on the pod at the top, but all of the saucer section is metal. So you can imagine the weight of that is really, really impressive. And there's a lot of detailing on there. I mean, you can see the number of windows displayed there. And the sort of the hull paneling detail as well. That's a really nicely done model. And you can see here as well that underneath the secondary hull doesn't have a neck. It's straight merged with the primary hull, unlike the Galaxy class. So this is why they look much narrower and much squatter. But you can see again the nacelles are exactly the same as the Galaxy classes. So it's but the thing is, it doesn't look like it's a they've been bolted on for the sheer hell of it. It's obviously the way in which this ship has been designed. So it's not like it's a kit bash of a Galaxy class. It just happens to be that they have very sensibly reused standard Galaxy class components in order to come up with a ship which is probably cheaper and easier to build than a Galaxy class, but has the same sort of large crew capacity and specialism capacity that a Galaxy class has as well. So I really liked them when I first saw them, because obviously they reminded me a lot of the Reliant, which is and the Mirandas, which is always a design that I've liked. But the sensor pod also makes a lot of sense. You can see how easy it would be for them to just sort of swap this out if they needed to. That wouldn't be a problem at all, and they'll just slot another one in space dock and off you go. So from a mission specializing sort of point of view, you know, it makes all sense in the world that they would design a ship with that sort of bolt on, if you like, even if you can only change it in space dock. It still makes perfect sense. Let's have a look at the stand. Now, I remember this was a challenging part for me. I have a smaller one. I don't think it was the Bonchune. It might have been the Phoenix. I always had a bit of an issue with the stand and where it was supposed to latch onto the Nebula. Now, let's see if I have the same issue with this one or not, because this is going to be heavy. So it's a similar sort of issue here, but it's that's much happier, I think. Let's have a look. Okay, she seems quite happy like that. I say it's a lot of weight for the Perspex to take, but it does seem to be quite happy taking it happily. So a little bit of polystyrene on her there. I must say, I've yet to have an Eaglemoss model come out of its box damaged. The only exception to that has been the Birds of Prey, because if you recall, they have disruptor cannons on their wingtips, and they're always plastic. And unfortunately, any sort of knock on those is going to bend them or indeed snap them off. So if you ever get a Bird of Prey, do be extremely careful. It's one of those things, the XL Bird of Prey that I have come so very, very close to completely snapping. In fact, no, I had to lie, I have snapped the disruptor off it, but I was able to fix it with what for me was a very conservative amount of clear glue. Because once you realise they're going to snap, you're almost drawn to snapping them for some bizarre reason. It's like part of you knows damn well what's going to happen, but you still end up doing it. I don't know what that means. But it is a slight frustration. I think they would be much better off making those out of die-cast metal, because I think that would be a lot safer. But I dare say it wouldn't be safer from the point of view of, you know, getting one into a young child's eye. So I don't know, it swings and roundabouts, isn't it? So there she is. Yeah, so I really like these. You see a fair few of them in the sort of the modern DS9 episodes, and I would guess they're designed to be a sort of Excelsior equivalent sort of vessel, and yet you still see a lot of Excelsior class ships bouncing around doing the sort of the courier roles for VIPs. So, you know, it's not entirely taken over, presumably because, you know, there just aren't as many. It's not as easy to create galaxy class holds, I guess, as it is to just keep reusing Excelsiors that are already there. But I think they're very, very capable ships. And I think this one, for example, turned up in Best of Both Worlds, and it turned up in, I think, in the Voyager finale as well, as they came home. So yeah, so it's they're nice ships. I do like them a lot, and I'm also quite happy with the way that's sitting on its stand as well. Now, there's a slightly funny story here, because in my head, I was going to stick this next to my Reliant to show how similar the Miranda and Nebula designs are. And when I realised I was going to do that, I then realised that I'd somehow managed to run out of room on my display, and I could have sworn that in my headspace I had enough slots left that I could put in the next ship that I'm going to show you. And unfortunately, I really, technically speaking, haven't. I have at the moment, because I don't have my Sovereign class Enterprise yet. That hasn't come. It's on pre-order, and they said November, but it hasn't arrived, and we're into the last few days of November now, so I'm hoping that's going to be here before long. But that hasn't arrived yet. It'll probably just sort of pop up at some point. But once that comes, I'm going to have to move my next ship somewhere else, I think, because I do like the idea of displaying this next to the Reliant, for obvious reasons. So I will leave this one here and get on with the next. Cheers for now.